No matter the context, the word piracy revolves around one idea: theft. The classic take on piracy brings us the image of pirates raiding and robbing ships at sea. And then there's software piracy, when you've bought one license to a computer program, but then install it on multiple devices. And then there are pirated goods, when people illegally copy and distribute movies, music, and books. Well, today we're talking about another form of piracy, biopiracy. That's when big companies take out patents to own the rights to living organisms like plants. That gives them exclusive rights to use those plants in their products. But many people say that's not fair, since local communities have often been using these plants in traditional medicine and for other purposes for centuries. This idea of big business exploiting plants and genes at the expense of people in the developing world has been a major talking point at COP16. That's the United Nations Biodiversity Conference, which just wrapped up in Cali, Colombia. So on today's episode, we're going to look at what biopiracy is and find out how governments are trying to mediate the issue. I'm William Lee Adams, and you're listening to What in the World from the BBC World Service. Let's start with an example. In 1994, an American company secured a patent for an antifungal product which used seeds from the neem tree, which is grown widely in India. 6 years later, the patent was revoked. An Indian agriculture company proved that it had been using an extract of neem tree oil for the same purposes as described in the company's patent and for several years before it was filed. In fact, Indians had, for hundreds of years, already used it as a medicine, insecticide, and even a contraceptive. That decision was a signal that the developing world is going to challenge this type of patent, and that fight continues today. Here to tell us more is our climate and science reporter, Georgina Ranard. Georgina, hello.
Hi, William.
So we're here to talk about what's informally known as COP16, or more officially, the 2024 United Nations Biodiversity Conference on the parties, of the parties even, to the UN Convention on Biological Diversity. So a lot of people are confused because they're like, COP29 is in November. Why are we talking about COP16? Could you explain the difference?
Yeah, so this is another one of those huge global meetings where all these people gather to try and fix one of these big issues facing our planet. So the one you just mentioned, the COP29, that's called the Climate COP. The other one is what we call the Nature COP. There is actually another one on desertification, but let's leave that till another day. This one's basically about how do we tackle the huge crisis facing nature, biodiversity, animals, plants, the oceans on our planet. It's a much younger meeting than the climate one. It's smaller. But what this meeting, which was in Colombia, has been trying to do is make progress on a really big agreement that was made 2 years ago by the same people in Montreal.
That agreement in Montreal, have we seen progress? How have things gone?
So that was a really landmark agreement. I feel like we use those words a lot, but it was one of the first times that global leaders and countries really agreed to try and protect huge amounts of nature on our planet. So they said that they would protect 30% of the world's oceans and land by 2030, reduce pollution, and generate huge amounts of money, around $200 billion a year by 2030. Unfortunately, there hasn't been a lot of progress since then. It's kind of been bogged down in discussions. This was only the first meeting since then, so these are every other year, unlike the Climate COP. So they met for 2 weeks, and actually at the weekend, they basically collapsed because not enough people were left to try and reach an agreement because there'd been so much discord, basically. There were a couple of things that passed, but overall, there wasn't a massive amount of progress on that big landmark deal.
There were, of course, a few areas where people did agree, and one of those is biopiracy. Could you tell us what that is?
Yeah, so I don't think it was called biopiracy by everyone at the talks, but that is generally how it's referred to. It is quite complex, so bear with me for a second, but it basically starts with the genetic material that we can get from the biological world. And now, because of sort of very rapid advances in science, there's huge databases of information free around the world made up of the genetic information, the sequencing from plants, from bacteria, from all sorts of elements of our natural world. that pharmaceutical companies, cosmetic companies, biotech can all use to develop new products. And those products are really important. They could be new drugs, they could be proteins, they could be technologies like enzymes that can eat plastic. And those products, as you can imagine, can also be worth billions of dollars. The natural world is really, really important to us in how we develop science, in drugs. But the question comes back to, where does the knowledge come from? Who found out about that plant originally? How did the scientists working for the big companies discover the information? And that's where we get into this biopiracy question, because often, or in a number of cases, it's relying on local knowledge or indigenous people. And the argument is that often Western countries are using that without paying for it along the way. They're accessing these really big databases where the information is free, but they're not paying for the costs along the way. So some people would say they're basically stealing knowledge for profit and they should start to pay for it. And I think what's really interesting is none of this is really very new. This type of interactions been going on for centuries. You know, you can think about the British Empire colonizing parts of the world in India or the Americas. And when they did that, they also took lots of science back. So it's this really like historical process. But what we're seeing now is the use of local knowledge to create these drugs that we all want to benefit from. It's not a simple theft. They don't just take it and apply it and put it in their drug. They're kind of taking elements of it with the sequencing. They're able to extract genetic information. And they do apply their scientific knowledge to turn it into a product. But the argument is that originally those products or that knowledge came from other countries. But the companies that are patenting it and are able to make a lot of money from it have never really paid for access to that information.
So just to recap, to make sure I'm understanding this correctly, a foreign company could patent the genetic material in natural plants or even animals without acknowledging where they come from, and then they don't always or ever share the profits.
Exactly. So there's quite a lot of different examples. There's one about anti-malarial treatment. So in the 2000s, some French researchers went to French Guiana. They talked to local people there who knew about anti-malarial plants. 10 years later, these researchers got a patent for a new compound from a local plant from French Guiana, which had these anti-malarial properties. So it wasn't developed in the same way as local people, but they added extra knowledge. So the argument is that because they used that local plant knowledge, they should have been paying for it along the way. But at the moment, that largely doesn't happen. And that's what some people are calling biopiracy.
So what's it like for the indigenous communities whose traditional knowledge is exploited by big business? We reached out to Natalie Canellis, an evolutionary biologist at the University of Copenhagen and the Royal Botanic Gardens at Kew here in London. She's part of the Amazonian Quechua community in Peru. She sent us this.
I am very much linked myself to my research. I'm a Quechua Amazonian from Peru, who focuses on evolutionary questions around plants and how the relationship between humans and plants has shaped plants into being considered quote-unquote useful. When these companies exploit and monopolize species or natural compounds, for sure they will disrupt ecosystems, leading to the loss of biodiversity, but also oftentimes polluting the land, rivers, and air, all of which are not only needed for a healthy life, but in our cultures, in our cosmovisions as indigenous peoples, they are very connected to our philosophy and the way that we live life. In Quechua, we call this ayin causai. As everything is connected, it also has an impact on our cultural heritage and identity, because it strips them from us, putting us and our future at higher risk, because through millennia, indigenous people have built like this very beautiful interconnectedness with nature and cosmos by tending and respecting other species and beings. And this knowledge that our ancestors have built through all this time is deeply embedded in our current culture, the way we live our daily practices, agricultural practices, health practices, and in the way also we see the world under which lenses. Also, it's like giving our legacy or to companies to grant them this external control of our species and knowledges to other companies. It it diminishes the self-determination and sovereignty that is much needed for indigenous peoples.
Central to this issue of biopiracy is money. Let's get back to my conversation with Georgina to find out more. How much money are we talking about here? Do companies stand to make millions, billions of dollars?
Yeah, I mean, this is a huge industry. We're talking about these really big pharmaceutical companies, cosmetics, biotech, which is a really fast-growing sector. It's one of the largest parts of the global economy, billions of dollars, definitely. That doesn't mean that all of that profit can be traced back to this genetic material, but that has definitely played a role along the way. And that's why at these talks, you know, there are lots of representatives from countries that have this local knowledge or have the local biodiversity. And they're saying, we need money to protect our nature and our biodiversity. We have this amazing natural resource that lots of other countries are benefiting from and not necessarily paying for it.
When we look to indigenous groups, people who have held this knowledge for centuries, what are the consequences for them when foreign companies come in and try to steal their knowledge?
So the argument is that these groups do not at all benefit financially from the knowledge, and they say it's basically stolen from them. And often they're also living in places that are on the front lines of the nature crisis. They're seeing rainforests being cut down, they're seeing depletion in soil. Of course, we know that animals, plants, insects, they're all declining in massive numbers around the world. And the argument is that in order to protect those areas, which are also where indigenous people live, they need a lot more money to do that. Not everyone wants to find the money to do it, to cough up that money. But they're saying, well, look, you're using our knowledge for these amazing scientific and financial advantages. Why can't you pay for that? And then we could use some of that to help pay for the costs of protecting nature.
How have companies responded to that? I mean, how do they justify not sharing the profits?
What companies say is that this information often is in this global database. It's sequenced by researchers, by scientists, and that is by and large free. So they're saying, well, there's huge scientific benefits to the world accessing this information. They say that that's what drives innovation, research, development. And what companies say is we need to have the best access to information, the raw materials of information, in order to create the best drugs that everyone wants. And the more you interfere with that, the less they're able to do it.
How have governments tried to mediate between the two sides?
So there have been some agreements in the past. There was the Nagoya Protocol in 2010, and that basically said that countries can regulate access to plants, animals, other parts of biodiversity in the sort of home country. And then other countries are supposed to make sure that the country or the companies use or basically give credit for the information they've used along the way with the consent of the original country. But on the other hand, countries, you know, if they've got a really successful pharmaceutical industry, it's in their interest to some extent to try and protect that because they want to have drug discovery in their country. They want to have these successful companies in their own country for tax reasons, for economic reasons. So I think they would say it's quite a difficult balance for them.
Georgina, thank you so much for explaining that.
Thank you, William.
Georgina mentioned that at COP16, a landmark agreement was reached to recognize the contributions of indigenous and local communities. The countries at the conference agreed to call on companies that make money from genetic information to pay some of their profits into a fund, which is being called the Cali Fund, after the Colombian city where the conference took place. It's voluntary for the companies to donate, but the agreement does allow governments to create laws that could force companies to contribute. The decision has been hailed as a sincere effort by governments to tackle biopiracy. And that has Natalie hopeful.
It gave me a lot of hope. Actually, I feel things are changing. More agency is given to our communities, to the people that are actually at the front lines, and like have these frameworks that benefits and encourages to ethically collaborate with indigenous and local communities.
That's all for today. Thanks for listening to another episode of What in the World from the BBC World Service. I'm William Lee Adams. We'll see you next time.